So today we start off with the topic of the extensible markup language or the XML. This is equally good important markup language. If we look in the series of the markup languages, we discussed about the HTML earlier, hypertext markup language, and this is the XML or the extensible markup language, way far and way advanced as compared to the HTML language. So first question that arises in the mind is, what is an XML language? So it stands for the extensible markup language. It's a markup language similar to the HTML in the sense that we have to write the code within the tags, and the reference will come, which will, when we see more differences in the HTML, all the tags are predefined, but here we can create our own tags. But yes, code has to be written all within the tags. So the HTML introduces the concept of the tags, the XML carries the same concept, and here we can create and define many, many more tags. The primary difference we can see, XML was designed to carry the data over the network. So formatting and indentation is very important, and the data is a user-defined data, not to display the data. Because if you look in the HTML, the primary objective of providing the user-defined tags, the primary objective of providing the system-defined tag to the end user was that he can design beautiful web pages, he can design attractive websites so that the hit count or the number of footfalls in the website always remains up, it keeps on always increasing. But XML is not designed for it, it is primarily designed for handling of the data, whereas HTML is designed for displaying of the data. So very important point that we need to remember in the discussion on the XML. The XML tags are not predefined, so it gives a flexibility and it gives me the comfort to create my own tags. That's the biggest advantage we get in the XML. So all those programmers who are bounded by the limitations of the HTML, that it makes you, it forces you to use its own defined tags. Now the programmer can create his own tags. The XML is designed to be self-descriptive, so it will provide the DTDs, the document type declaration, as well as document type definitions, which helps us to make the XML as descriptive in nature. And it has the blessings of W3C, the World Wide Web Consortium, so we can always believe that it's got a very bright future, because W3C is a very, gives very push to the open source scripting and open source technologies like HTML, the JavaScript, the PHP. So they take care of the growth, they take care of the tags, they keep on enhancing the these languages. So W3C has a very strong backing for the XML. Now, from where does it come from? So the father portal is the father founding figure is W3C, World Wide Web Consortium. So W3C created a XML working group, which was chaired by John Bosack from the Sun Microsystem. So we're talking of early 90s, when Java was coming in its full bloom. And so everything was being done by the Sun Microsystem. And the biggest USP of the Sun Microsystem was that they were providing everything as a open source. And that poses a huge challenge to the Microsoft also at that point of time. And they were, if you're a good, having a good track of the IQ knowledge of the quizzes, and you keep a track of these companies, even the both of these companies fought in the US court of law regarding the Java, because Microsoft introduced the Visual Java, VJ++, and Sun Microsystem has got the backing of Java. Finally, Sun Microsystem won that court case, but in the entire process, it totally got bankrupted. So the biggest problem of working in the open source is that the companies don't get a huge amount of the revenue. So money is a big problem in running of this company, because how do you pay your programmer? How do you pay for the software and the hardware cost? How do you pay for the office spaces? That's one of the biggest problem working in the open source. That is why they always go for donations. For example, if you have been browsing the Wikipedia pages in the recent past, even they are going for donations, because open source don't have a money. So only the contribution come from the philanthropist or from some of the technical tech companies who are ready to pay the money for the maintenance of the servers, for paying the programmers who keep on updating the web pages. So huge amount of the cost is required to carry on the open source philosophy. That's one of the biggest problem in working of the open source. Because how do you earn the money? How do you generate the revenue? That's why if you look at the Indian horizon, there are many few companies who work in the open source. Almost majority of the Indian companies are tech companies who speak who totally into the money making business. They don't delve into the open source, and neither they share anything in the open source. There's a bit of difference between when we talk of the free and open source. FOSS, FOSS. Free means the software is free to use. You can download the software and then you can start using it. Just like we use a WinZip and WinRAR utilities. They are free to use. Again, free means I may have certain trial version for the software. I may not give it completely free of cost. So I say use it for 15 days and thereafter start paying for it. Just like Adobe uses for their own PDF editors. They give you free of cost for a period of 7 to 10 days and then they say you will start charging you. So free means free to use completely for life or free to use for restricted period of time. But then they are not charged at that till that point of time. After that becomes unchargeable. But when we talk of the open source means totally free, free to use, and they also share the source code. Just like we got a Linux flavors, Ubuntu, Fedora, Gentoo, many number of the Linux kernels are there. I can download free of cost. Even the source code is available. So free may not be open source, but open source is always free. So you can download the code, you can edit the code, you can redistribute the code, you can share the code. But open source philosophy says whenever you work in the open source and if you're modifying the source code and redistributing it, you should always give the acknowledgement and maybe some donation to the company from you have borrowed the source. Means it should not work like that. If tomorrow I start up a tech company in US ICT, I use open source, means I use a front end Java programming language. I use start using the back end as MySQL, which is free of cost. I carry out connectivity using the JDBC. And then I don't use the Windows operating system. I use the Fedora or Ubuntu or Gentoo, any other of the Linux as a base operating system. And then I build a commercial software and then I start selling it. So that's against the open source philosophy. Once you have built the software using the open source softwares and the projects, you should not sell it for commercial operation. And if you do that, then you should always pay the money back to the company from whose software you have used, whose open source software you have used for build your own commercial software. So proprietary licenses only come into the picture in the proprietary world. In the open source, we believe if you are using some other company's software, then if you're trying to sell it, making money out of it, then you should always pay back to the original company from whom you borrowed the software or you downloaded the software. Otherwise, it goes against the ethics of the open source. If you have got a time and if you browse the Google, there's a person by the name Richard Stallman. He founded a company called FSF, Free Software Foundation, in 1984. And that was a company who started this open source philosophy for the very first time. That let's build the code, let's share the code among the programmers. Whatever they think like, they will do it. So that was a movement that started. But again, this movement goes against the policies or the guidelines of the big tech companies, Microsoft, Amazon, Adobe, Google, IBM. They do not follow the open source philosophy. So these companies never want the open source philosophy to actually thrive. So they always do something or the other to make sure that the open source philosophy is derailed and it never really picks off. So because they, and it's not that they also don't do it. Some of the time or the other, for those of the software become totally redundant, which are useless. Then they share it free of cost. So those, they start dumping into the tech world that these are the software which are no longer is using. Now they will share it as a source code to the programmer that now you can, if you want, you can start using it at your own end. So XML, HTML, JavaScript, even in that Java programming language and that was Java world, it's all open source. So that's the biggest USP for working in this programming language. You don't have to pay anything to anybody. No proprietary licensing are required. So John Bostick was a part of this open source world. He was there in the Sun Microsystem and he carried on the movement of development with this XML language. So we give the credit of HTML to Tim Berners-Lee. And for the XML, we give the credit to the John Bosack. And the group included the representative for Microsoft, Netscape, HP, and Adobe. So this is how they have evolved. Right in the first, we have got the general markup language way back in the 60s. Then we came with the SGML standard generalized markup language or called the SGML language. Then in 19, the Tim Berners-Lee came up with the HTML, the hypertext markup language. And then 96, John Bosack and the other group came up with the XML or the extensible markup language. So they have been there for almost 25 years now, 24 years to be precise, and lot many changes have happened in the last 10 years or so in the growth of the XML language. So this goes as a brief history of the XML. The evolution of the XML started in 96, and the first working draft came up in the November 96. In 97, the XML parser was introduced for the very first time. There is a very popular parser called MS XML, Microsoft XML Parser, which they've introduced as one of the parser for these markup languages. In 97, the first XML application was developed in the tech world. In 98, XML 1.0 recommendation was published, and largely they grew up from that point of time. So now we have got the XML 1.0, 1.1, and 1.2 also. So multiple version of the XML has come into the being. Now, the biggest question that comes into my mind as a student should be, what is the difference between the XML and the HTML? If we already have a very beautiful language called hypertext markup language, then why do I require the XML? So the first line, we always say XML is not a replacement of the HTML. It was neither intended to be and neither it is. Both have their own pros, both of them have their own cons. So we never say which is a perfect language. It just depends upon my application. What is my requirement? What kind of web page I'm going to design? So accordingly, I can choose any of these markup languages. So no one is a substitute for one another. All these languages have got their own importance. Both of them were designed for different goals. And what are these goals? XML was designed to transport and store the data with the focus on what data is. That is what the importance of the XML is. So they will carry the data on the web. The browser understands the XML today. They help us to store the data in the form of tags on the web servers. Whereas HTML was designed to display the data with a focus on how the data look to the end user. So how appealing, how refreshing I can design a particular web page on a website. We can take a simple example. Suppose I'm building a house. So every room will have a four walls around it. Now, what is the quality of the construction material I use? Means how much amount of brick, mortar, cement, and what composition I use these constituents. So that will make up the quality of the wall. How strong and sturdy my wall actually becomes. And now to the end user, I will apply the exterior finishing. Plain coat of the paint. So what the paint is synonym to the HTML, how it will look to the end user. So I can have the brush painting, I can have a designer painting, or I can keep my wall simple. I can use the Asian paint, royal color, or I can use any other berger paint. So many colors comes with the varying cost. So I can design on how the wall will look like to the visitors who will come to my house, the guest who will come to my house. So they will only look on the external finishing, how the wall is, but they will not be able to look into the interiors, that what is actually the wall made up of. So the XML goes behind the scene. The user will not be able to appreciate the importance or the value of the tags which is being defined by the XML. But what they will look like is only the HTML, the exterior finishing of the web page. How is it looking to the end user? Only when some amount of water peeps into the wall or the ceiling comes, then everyone says that the quality of the wall is poor. Otherwise, if everything goes fine and well, you apply wallpaper on your wall, they're all HTML, how it will look to the end user. But they will not go beyond that what has gone into the composition or the creation of that particular wall. What are the composition of the material has been used? In what composition, what has been constituted by it? So XML goes behind the scene, not visible much to the user, but HTML is something that will always be visible to the user. So HTML is all about displaying the information, while the XML is about carrying the information on the web between the client, between the server, or between server to server. So any kind of the communication that happens on the web can only be done with the help of the XML. So carrying on more differences, the first difference we can see, it was introduced by Tim Berners-Lee, all managed and maintained by the W3C. In fact, both of them are managed and maintained by the W3C, both the HTML as well as XML along with the JavaScript. We will do more tags of the JavaScript in our labs, because theory is we already discussed about the JavaScript, not much more to be added in it. But yes, we will discuss more about JavaScript in our labs as and when we'll have it. Discuss more about the event handling model, the various kind of the events which are there in the JavaScript, the on-click, on-submit events, and how we can use it. The stable release for the HTML is 5.5, whereas for the XML is 1.2, which is the stable release, but popular is still the 1.1. Then the third point we can see, HTML is primarily used for data presentation. That's what the objective is, both structured as well as the unstructured data. Our focus is more on visualization and image representation. So how I should make my web page more attractive and appealing to the end user? What should be the color contrast I should use on my website? What is the amount of the white space that should be left, and what is the color combination I should use it? So a lot of focus goes on designing of these apps as well as the websites. If you look at the Facebook, if you look at the WhatsApp, if you look at the Gmail, if you look at the Hotmail, many number of the attractive creative web designers are hired by these companies to design on these web pages, that how to make them much more appealing. Let's say Instagram, Snapchat, all these social networking apps and sites pay a lot of focus, even the Twitter for that matter, what should be the color combination to be used by the end user. And the primary look and feel of all these social networking apps, tools and application, if you see, is the white color, because white color does not put stress on the human eyes and it looks refreshing. And the color contrast doesn't have to be very dark in color. So, and the font size has to be medium size, not very small, not very large, whether it has to be bold and italic, everything has to be very carefully thought of. And you keep on getting feedback from the user that how, what all they will look like. You don't want to load your website with too much amount of data. Nobody would like to see too much amount of data onto the homepage of the website or on the subsequent pages of the website. So task of designing the web page is very crucial and very important, because a lot of thing has to go on the positioning of the content. Are the images required? If yes, then what should be the size and pixels of these images? So a lot of focus has to go on the designing of these websites, and HTML and XML play a very important role in handling of the tags for these websites. So HTML makes use of predefined tags, and the XML makes use of the user defined tags. So UDT, it gives me the flexibility to that. Now all those who of you who are you doing web based projects or web development projects, make sure that we design the attractive portals, portal which have got a good soothing eye color combination, and the end user feels good in designing of these web pages. Look good to see these web pages. So when you present your work to the external examiner in the month of November and of December, the first look and feel is very important to the examiner. How is your website or app is actually looking up? And then he will go into the integrities of the project, that what all the project is all about and how I should do it. And as we were discussing in the last class also, a lot of focus has to go on the analysis and design phase. Don't just go through it in a hush-hush manner, quick manner. Spend the entire month of the September in just going for the analysis and design phase of your project. Make sure that we design the IEEE SRS format, which will be required in the final project report. So make sure we do it in the month of September itself. We design the diagrams, the UML diagrams. And now which kind of UML diagram you want to use, that's for you to decide. The class diagram, the sequence diagram, the component diagrams, the use case diagrams, which all diagrams are required, but make sure we do it. We design a data flow diagram, because data flow diagrams are very important. That will give you clarity on how to build up an entire project. So data flow diagrams are very, very important. Make sure we do it, because in the midterm evaluation with that we'll have in the month of October, we'll be looking into all these things, that whether the student has prepared all these documents or not. And once you are through with it, then you start with the coding. So don't just launch yourself into the coding. Coding is not everything about the project development, and neither project development is all about coding. 50% is all these design documents and manuals which are required in place before your actual coding launches. Because what you problem you might face in the coding, the entire project will get cleared up in your mind right in the analysis and design phase. So don't jump to the coding right in the very first go. Make sure your database gets completely right up there in place. AR diagrams are designed. And then in the month of October 1st, we can just actually start with the coding. So once you've prepared well yourself in the month of September with all the analysis and design phase of the document, then there should not be any problem in the coding. But if you do it other way around, you will have a problem in both the phases. Because in the coding, you will keep on encountering many, many problems. and those problems you will have manually sorted out on paper while designing all these documents. That what are the different classes in my data flow diagram? Because if you look at the process which are there in data flow diagram, they actually become the classes in the front end programming language. So the more the number of the process you have got in the DFDs, the same will become the classes. When we talk of the data elements in the DFD, they become the variables in the case of the classes. So it's very important that we do the design and analysis of the document first, the projects first, followed by the actual coding. And the last date remains same, 14 September. So make sure we get it done before 14 September. No submission will be accepted whatsoever after 14 September. So everyone should be very conscious of it. If your guide has a problem in signing of the document, then make sure we send the document to guide well in time, and he can reply a mail to you that he is satisfied or not satisfied, or he has suggested certain improvements, and make sure you have done those improvements well in time. And so even if he doesn't sign it, because he might have a problem of taking a printout or putting a signature on the soft copy of a document, just ask him or her to revert a mail back to you that he or she is satisfied with the synopsis. And then you can attach the mail in your PDF file, merge two of them, and then you mail it to me that this is my final project with a consonance of the guide that he or she is satisfied with. So when he will reply back a mail to you, generate a print, take a PDF of that mail, merge that PDF file with your synopsis. There are many number of the websites that go for the merging of the PDF, and then mail me the final consolidated PDF file by 14 September 5 p.m. Not before, after that, we will not accept it. So make sure we respect the deadline and prepare our synopsis well in time. I've already shared few points which I think Shraddha has already forwarded. So make sure we follow those points, and anything if you want to add from your guide, no problem. Feel free to add whatever you would like to, but minimum these points have to be catered to in the preparation of the synopsis. Anything else you want to add, or if your guide asks you to add it, you can also always add it. So more is always welcome, but nothing should be less than this than what has been suggested. So coming back to the differences, point number 5. Here the output is highly dependent on the underlying web browser in the case of the HTML, and this is not the case in the case of the XML. So the output of my XML page will be independent of the underlying web browser. Now both these languages have the objective. So when we talk of the HTML, we say primary objective is for designing a markup language for human to machine and machine to human interaction. So I as an end user can view the web page, I can interact with the web page, I can enter the values to the GUI components displayed as a part of the HTML page. But here we are primarily designing for machine to machine interaction. So client talking to server, or server talking to client, or server to server communication. So focus is more on the system to system communication rather than on the you getting a human involved into it. So that is why we always say XML works behind the scene. It is primarily used for carrying the data on the web, rather than involving the user into it. End user has very limited role to play in the case of the XML. It's only for the programmers, it's only for coders and developers that they use it for carrying out their project buildup, the web-based scenario. Then a point number, repeated, no problems. Not suitable for web services transmission, and XML is primarily suitable for the web services transmission. The HTML does not make use of DTD. So here we are talking of document type definition. Now when we talk of the DTD, there are two expansion of this world: document type declaration and document type definition. HTML makes use of document type declaration. It does not make use of the document type definition. But when we talk of the XML, it makes of use both of them. Document type declaration which comes first, followed by the document type definition which comes later on. We'll see the difference between the two, so don't worry. But yes, it makes use of both of them. And primary objective of document type definition is for the validation of the XML document. That how is my page very strong, robust, dynamic, and sturdy? And that's all possible only because of the usage of the XML. Now, this is how the typically a page look like. XML page, if you look at the root element of the XML, it's a tag. For example, if I want to define the information about the student, so I create a tag by the name student. Then it goes as a, which say we say the root element of the XML. Then within the student tag, I create a sub tag, what we call sub element of the student note. So student becomes my root note, and in the entire XML document, there will be only one and only one root note. I will not have multiple root notes. So we create a sub element of the student node, and this element will have an attribute, let's say standard. So attribute is the standard, and so as a programmer, I will define my own attributes. I will define my own tags, and then we initialize a value, let's say first standard. So within quotes, the first. Now within this mail tag, I will have sub element of the mail tag, sub element of the mail element. First, let's say name, then age, then marks. So these are the sub tags I create under the mail tag, and mail tag is a child tag under the student tag. So if I only want to say in terms of the tags, student is the first tag, mail is a child tag of it, and name, age, and marks are the sub tags of the mail tag. If it, I talk of the terms of element, so we'll have the root element, then the sub element of the root element, and the sub sub element of the root element. Now within the name tag, we specify the value of the name is which name. So we say John is the name of the student. What is his age? 6 is his years. Then marks, what is the percentage of marks he has scored? So 90.45. So this text value or the number, they all become the value for the marks element. So these are all the marks which we have to hard code. Now either they will be received as an input from some HTML page, or we are going to write or hard code it within the tags. So this mail or this mail tag is carrying the information about one student. Same way I can replicate it multiple number of times to create the information about more number of students in the class. So student tag or the student root element will keep on running. It will keep on happening. So it is the first tag to open up and last tag to close down. But within it, I can create multiple number of the sub tags. So I can have the male tag, I can have the female tag, and so on. I can create multiple number of tags within my XML page. So this is how typically it looks like, which we have seen in the near example. So how we'll map it in the code? The very first line says, within angular brackets, we write question mark, XML, which is the name of the markup language which we are using. Then what is the version I am using? So I can have the version 1.0, 1.1, or 1.2. Three versions are there. The stable version release is the 1.1 and 1.2. 1.0 is stable release. So that is how we write the prologue section, the very first section of my XML program. So XML declaration goes into the very first part of the prologue section of the XML page. Then we define a root tag. And as we discussed in the previous slide, we'll have only one and only one root tag in the entire XML page. We'll not have the multiple root tags. So within this root tag, I can define my own tags. So result becomes that first nested tag or the child tag of the root tag. Now this result will have an attribute. What we say time is becomes the attribute of it, and we specify the value, let's say 200 seconds. So node is become node attribute is what we are referring to. Now within this result tag, I can have the further child tags. So value, value, and value. That's the three child tags, each having the different attribute, like ID is equal to length, and then we hard code the value 33.3. Then again, we define another value, ID is equal to score. So this time the name is a score, and the node value is 1.00. And whether the status is pass or not, so status is equal to fail. So why is this called because empty? Because there's no ID for it. So it is just a tag name, attribute name, and then we hard code the value as fail. And then we close down the result tag, which is a part or the child of the root tag. So root tag will be the first tag to open up in the entire XML program, and will be the last tag that will close down in the entire XML program. And everything will be encapsulated within this root tag. Now, if you look at the following example, it's a very simple example, how the XML code is written within a document. So we'll start with the root tag. Let's say a note, it becomes a root tag. Then to whom I am sending to, so I create my own tag by the name to. Now the XML is case sensitive, so you should be very careful that we write when a lowercase and the uppercase does not have to be going the same thing. If you're writing a document in the lower cases, make sure we write all the tags in the lower cases. If I'm coding in uppercase, I should code all the tags in the uppercase. So to, and then the name of the student, let's say Saloni. Then who is sending the message, let's say from Anita. Now these are the to and from, these are the tag which we are creating as a programmer. So this is not possible in the case of the HTML, but it is very easily gets done in the case of the XML or the extensible markup language. Then if I want to create my own heading and the message, I can always do that. So I can create the own heading tag, let's say reminder. So opening tag will not have a forward slash, but as the HTML told us or taught us, closing tag will always have a forward slash embedded within it. So forward slash and the heading. Then the message, don't forget my birthday party, any kind of the message you would like to welcome to the XML language, or if there is a communication between two friends, they would like to invite each other for some celebration, they can always write their own message. So we create our own tag and then write the code within that tag, whatever message you would like to write, that becomes get and then the hard coded. And then we close down the tag, the message tag, and finally the root tag, which is a note in this case. So root tag is the first tag to open up and the last tag to close down. And for closure, we always know there is always a forward slash embedded within this tag. Now, where do we write this code, the XML code? One of the option is that we write the code within the simple notepad file, save it with the .xml extension and give it as an input to our web browser. Now, depending on the version and the type of the browser you are using, some of the browsers have got XML parser inside them, some have do not have them. So they might be able to interpret your code, they might not be able to interpret your code. So it primarily depends upon the which version of the browser you are using and which kind of the browser you are using. So all these browsers have their own documentation and they tell very clearly to the user that whether they support the XML tags or not. So when I will give the demo, so we can use it in the browser, or there are certain editors that's primarily designed for the XML. Just like one is the Oxygen XML editor, which falls into a category of the free software. They give the access free of cost to a period of 30 days. So they will ask you to enter your email ID when you go to the website of this Oxygen XML portal. And once you enter your email ID, they will send you the key. Then you download the software. And when you install this Oxygen XML editor, then you copy and paste the key from your mailbox and then paste it here. And then carry out the installation of the Oxygen XML software. So they would like to have a first-hand registration of the participant who would like to use the Oxygen XML or editor. And they also keep a track of your email IDs. So they will send you the key for the installation of software on your mail ID. And after 30 days, they will again remind you of that if you are more interested, then you can pay the version, pay some cost, maybe a monthly cost or an annual cost to the Oxygen XML editor company, or they totally disable and deactivate the software. So 30 days trial version is free of cost by these companies. So you can write your own code within this duration of the time. And you can always write within XML, within a browser, that's not a problem. But if you want to have an editor that caters to the understanding of the XML language, there are many a number of the free and open source editors. So Oxygen is one of them, very popular, that provides you the environment where you can write your own XML code. That is all we'll keep updated till now, and the DTD we'll discuss in our next class. So is the code visible? A quick yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Okay, fine. So we use the encoding schemes, especially when we would like to have an exchange of the data and the messages between the programs belonging to different programming language. That we talk of the word interoperability. Suppose I design a program in C++ and I would like to communicate it with a Java program. And let us say vice versa. A Java program would like to talk to a C++ program. So the input of C++ might go as a, output of C++ might go as input to Java program, or the output of Java program might go as an input to the C++ program. Now both these programming languages have the different kind of the character set. So this is where we require the encoding scheme. So when we say UTF-8, that means a 32-bit character set markup language can communicate with a programming language that supports the 8-bit character set. So we require something called the compression in the data set. Otherwise, we might have a loss data. What is the lossless and lossy two kind of the compression technique here? So here it is a lossless compression technique, where we'll make sure that the language, the markup language, which is supporting a big character set, is able to pass the data or the information to the programming language that is supporting a small character set. Now, this will not be the problem other way around. A programming language supporting a smaller character set can always freely communicate with a markup language supporting a large character set. Because when you move from the lower grade to the upper grade, you do not have a problem. But when we do it other way around, moving from the higher grade to the lower grade, we need to carefully, critically handle the data. Otherwise, the data loss can take place. So we have got different kind of the encoding scheme to sort out this problem. UTF-8 is one of them. UTF-16, and then we have got UTF-32 also for the interoperability between the programming languages or the markup languages. Now this in itself is a good project where we talk of the communication between the programming languages. For example, C++ support multiple inheritance, Java does not support multiple inheritance. So what if the two programs which are linked to of inheritance, they try to communicate with each other? C++ support operator overloading, Java does not support operator overloading. So how do you handle this kind of concept? So even doing interoperability is a good full-fledged project where you handle the incompatibilities between the programming languages. Then we define a root tag, which is university. Now within the university, you have got different schools, what we call university school of studies, USS. So there are around 11 schools in our university. We are not talking affiliate colleges, only the university school of studies. Now within it, we have got, of course, our own school, the USICT. Now, so we define a root tag called USS. Within it, we have got a child tag called USICT. Now within it, we define a title tag. So we define it in lowercase. So this is all in the uppercase, we don't have any issue. But if you write in a lowercase, starting tag, then ending tag should also be in the lowercase. So the title, language is equal to, and the English. Thereafter, we specify the name of the school, USICT, and we close down the title tag. Now within it, we give a profile of our school. So we say dean, and we write the name of the dean, angular closing of the tag of the dean. Then the duration, how long she will remain a dean from 2017 to 2020. So we specify the from tag and the to tag for it. Starting duration and the ending duration. This is how we go for the nesting of the tags. So at this point of time, we have a root tag open. Then USICT, which is a root, which is a child tag of the USS. Then duration. Now within duration, we have got a from and the to. Then we specify the room number tag, we specify the email address, then we close down the USICT, close down the USS, and then close down the university. That's how typically it will look like. Now if I want to execute the program, what we can do, we can go to the view, current file in, and we go for the code. So this is how the program will typically look like. We can expand or compress these tags the way we want. Program output visible on the screen? Quick yes or no? Is the program output visible?
Yes, visible.
So we can expand or compress the USS, the USICT. Again, these are all the child tags under the USS, and then we can further expand it. Then we can have the profile of D, the duration, and so on. That is how typically the output of the XML page will look like. Now let's take another program. This is a program that talks of the books, the books in the library. So in the very first line of code, we have a document type declaration. So we'll call it XML version is equal to 1.0 encoding scheme and the UTF-8 encoding scheme. The concept of the UTF encoding scheme is the same what we discussed in the earlier program. So it will be universal character set transformation format. So universal character set. So that's how the program looks like, universal character set and the transformation format. And then we need to uncomment it. Yes. Now this is how the program will look like now. So we'll have the bookstore. And the bookstore will have the book category tag. So there can be multiple number of the book category tag. So we're going to be defining this first book. Within it, we have got a category. And within the category, we have using quotes equal to network. So we are taking the first category of the book. Now we give the details about this book first. So title, language is equal to English. Then computer network, we close down the title tag. We specify the name of the authors, Andrew S. Tenenbaum. Then we specify the year as 2005, and then the price is 300 rupees. So we specify the first book within the bookstore, the book tag. Then we come to the second book. So we again say book category is going to programming, then title language is going to be English, the Java 2 complete preference, then author is equal to Patrick Norton, and we close down the author tag. Then we specify the year as 2010, price as any kind of the integer or the floating number, not a problem at all, because it's our own user defined tag. Then we come to the book category is equal to software engineering. Then title language is equal to within quotes the English. Then author, we specify the name of the author. One of the widely used book in India for software engineering is by Professor Yogesh Singh. Sir is a professor in our department, but right now he is gone on deputation as a vice chancellor for Delhi Technological University, which I think you would have already the name of the vice chancellor. So sir, but is a professor in our department. He is the founder, head and the founder dean of the USICT. Then we come to the year tag. So 2011, and then price 1000 rupees. So what we do here, we in the bookstore, we define three tags. First tag is for the category called network. Second tag is for the category of programming. And third tag is the category for the software engineering. And within these tags, we define further user defined tag that talks about the information about the author, year, and the price. So we can execute the program. So view current file in, and we come to the pro. So this is how my program will look like in a browser window. We can compress and expand the tags the way we would like to do them, that we can enjoy full liberty. Something like the program might just look like this, just having a root tag. Then I can expand it further. So book category is equal to network, and the other informations are hidden. Then again, book category is programming. The other information are hidden, but I can expand it further to get more information about that particular book. That is how it will look like. So I can have multiple number of the tags within the same web page of the XML. Now let us see one more program that talks of the DTD. So this is a very small, simple, elegant program that talks of the earlier programs were our well-formed XML document. Now this program is well-formed, plus it is DTD based, so it's a valid XML document. Well-formed XML document coupled with or added with a DTD is called a valid XML document. Now if you look here, it's a very small program, 30 lines of page, but it talks sense in the sense that we have multiple sections here. First section is a prologue, where we talk of the XML version, which is 1.0, and the encoding scheme is UTF-8, Universal Character Set, which is the name of a character set supported by the XML language, and the encoding scheme based on this character set, which is UTF-8, 8-bit encoding scheme. Now what we do here, we defined a DTD here. This is called document type definition. So let's see the syntax first. We start with the less than, then exclamation sign, then doc type, and we specify the name of the DTD. It is university in this case. Now, ideally speaking, whatever name we give here, we must specify the same name here. We must specify the same name here, and we must specify the same name here. Because document type declaration, after the document, when we start the DTD, this name should match with the root tag. So this becomes a root tag here. So we call it within the, we start with the square bracket, open square brackets, and then the closing square brackets. So angular brackets, less than symbol, exclamation mark, element, university. Then now we need to specify that within the DTD part, that there will be an XML page which will have a university tag inside, the root element inside it. Now this will have three further child elements, what we call child tag as name, place, and city. So we are specifying that. Right now we are not doing the coding, we are just specifying the structure or the schema of the XML document, which the XML parser is likely to get. Now we also involve XML parser that there will be three further child elements. One will have a name, another will have a place, and the third will have the city. Now they will be what type? So we are specifying their types. So we say hash TC data, parsable character data. So when we use the word TC data, we mean parsable character data. So this is, we are informing to the XML parser that within the XML page, the parser is going to get a university as a root tag. That university tag will have further three child tags. First is the name, the place, the city. We can have the email address also. We can have the phone number also. We can add more information. But minimum, it is going to have the three kind of the tag. And what will be the data of these tags? We can have the C data, which is character data, or we can have the PC data, the parsable character data. So parsable character data will include any kind of data like the characters, integers, byte, float, boolean, any kind of the data. But when we use only hash C data, it will only use the character data. So it's always better that when you are defining a DTD, go for the PC data right in the very first code. Then we'll have place and then the city. And then we close down the document type definition. So this is what the small DTD is. And it is a part of the same XML document in which it has been written. Alternatively, just like the JavaScript, we can create, just like in JavaScript, we can have the internal inline referencing as well as external scripting. Same way, we can have the internal DTD or the external DTD. We'll see the external DTD program in the next class, but here for the time being, we have the internal DTD, where the DTD is embedded within the XML page. Then we define a university tag. Then we define the name, place and city, the three tags inside it. So we specify the name of a university, GGSIP University, then place Dwarka, city Delhi, and then we close down the university tag. Now the data written here within the tag should match with the data type specified in the DTD, because that is what the purpose of DTD is, to validate the content of the XML document. So if I want to execute it, so I go view, current file in and Chrome. So this is how the small output look like. So we can expand it or compress it the way you would like to do it. University, it is having name, GGSIP University, place Dwarka, city Delhi and the user. So what the output and the syntax of the program matches to the rules, regulation and specification written down in the DDD. That is what the advantage of using DDD in a program. That you can apply the validation and make your XML page comply to those validations. If it does, we say it's a valid XML document. If it does not do that, it is only the XML well-formed XML document. It's a document which is only conforming to the rules and regulation of the as specified W3C, but not conforming to the DTD, the document type definition. That is what is the well-formed XML document. So that is all we'll discuss in today's class, because when we start the next class, next program, then we won't be able to complete it. So tomorrow we'll see the Oxygen XML editor. That's an editor we use when we do not use a browser for writing and executing the XML programs.